Also in the village, you know, God spoke to us that we should build, you know, a two-bedroom house for the pastors and furnish each bedroom with a double bed and a double mattress. You know, by that time we're going towards 5 years now in ministry in the village. And God spoke to us so clear that we should do that. And that's how we started building the house. And finally we finished that house. We furnished with a double bed and double mattress. Immediately we finished building that house, we heard a voice to say, now you move, time up, you have to go to town, to Livingstone. You know, that's how we just packed. We had nothing to pack really. We just had some blankets and some few things, and we just packed. By the time the farmers woke up, we were gone to Livingstone. We landed in Livingstone. We didn't have anything, for sure. We didn't have anything when we reached Livingstone to go and pioneer some work there. We literally had nothing at all. And we just had money, which we raised from the little garden that we had. And we used to sell some vegetables there. But the amount that we got, we were able to pay for 3 months. The fourth month, we had nothing at all. You know, I remember it was a day like tomorrow, we have to pay for our rentals. You know, I didn't have not even any cent or anywhere in my pocket. You know, I went in the bedroom, I said, God, if really you called me, if you called me and I heard your voice, you show up. Show up. You know, and I remember that day when I prayed. In the evening, around, you know, 5 o'clock in the evening, I received a note from the landlord. She was an orphan. She was surviving through that house. And she stated in her note to say, I feel you should not pay anything this month. You don't need to pay for accommodation this month. It amazed me. At the same time, it encouraged me because I prayed about it. And that was a source of encouragement to me. So that month, we were given a grace period. We didn't pay anything. And I remember the same month, I was preaching in the street, and then I heard a vehicle coming behind me, and it stopped. And someone called my name, said, James. I looked back. It was an old friend from school, and his name is Freddy. So he said, James, you are here? I said, yes, I'm here. So what are you doing? I told him. I said, I'm doing ministry, you know. So he says, I'm going to come home. So he came home, you know. We didn't talk much. He said, no, James, let me just tell you what I heard when I entered this house. I've not asked anything, you know, from you. But this is what I heard God tell me to say, from today, I need to start paying for your accommodation. I don't know who pays for accommodation, but God spoke to me that I should start paying for accommodation. And it was so amazing to me because I didn't think that way, you know. So that man started to pay for accommodation for more than 2 years. He was paying for accommodation, faithfully paying for accommodation. When we reached there, we didn't just start the church immediately. We did some map about that area, the catchment area, that we felt God wanted us to start, you know, the church. So we called someone who knew the place very well. He gave us a map, and we started praying, you know, praying. We called it our Jerusalem. We started praying about it, claiming souls there, and also praying that God is going to help us, you know, to pioneer the work for 3 months. After 3 months, we felt we should now start the work. And we started the work with my wife and also my child. I mean, my child by then. And whilst we were there, God spoke to us that we need to get to one of the vulnerable child and just keep that child, adopt that child. And that's how we went. We adopted one child, and that made us to be four now. You know, and we started the church with four members, my children, my wife, and me, and adopted a child. And we just started in a classroom. You know, we went now in the streets doing door-to-door evangelism. I remember the first time that we started the work, we were just five of us. And we did a lot of evangelism in the streets and door to door. And some people came in, you know, and the church began to grow from there. And one day I went to visit one of my members. He was staying in a shant compound. And when I reached there, she told me there was someone who came from Lusaka, who was the neighbor there. So I went to see that couple, and I just found the wife. The man had not yet come from Lusaka. And the wife told me to say she was a Christian, but the husband was not a Christian. you know. So I asked her when the husband was going to, you know, to be in, and she gave me that date. Then I went to see the husband, and apparently the husband was vaccinated, used to drink, you know. So that's how I started sharing the gospel. The power of God hit him, and he became, you know, revived. He became, he came back to the Lord, and 2 months later, I didn't know that this man had a plot somewhere. 2 months later, he came to me and he said, "Pastor, I was talking with my wife. I just felt I should give my plot to the church so that you can build a church. I really appreciate God for what he has done in my life to change my life, and this is all that I can offer." So we went to see the place, and for sure we saw the place. It was a good one. And that's how we started building, you know, on that plot, you know, until it reached about the roof level, you know. So during that time, I heard the voice to say, "We have to move out of the school and go to that that structure." But then there was no roof, you know. That's how we moved to that structure, you know. Livingstone is a hot area, it's a hot place, you know. And it was not pleasant for me as a pastor, because you find the people putting their Bibles on their head because of the heat. Sometimes they would put their veils around their head as if they are Muslims because of the heat. And I didn't feel well seeing them that way. Sometimes I would even reduce the service so that at least I save the people from the heat, you know. And we didn't know for sure where salvation was going to come from. I didn't know, I had no idea. And now we are croaking, we are getting close at the rain season. And sometimes I would think, did I really hear properly, you know? Am I not going to lose the church because the rain season is coming? And very few people would stand, withstand, you know, the rains. And somehow, sometimes I would come to the fresh and say, maybe I'll lose the church. But I just believed, because God said, you have to move out. I believe somehow, somewhere, something was going to happen. I don't know how, but something was going to happen. God was going to help us so that we are not soaked during the rain season. It was at that time that God came through. You know, someone I met some time back, by the name of Gary, he called me. He said, "I'm coming to visit you with a friend." And that's how they came. And they found us in that open place, just with walls around it, you know. And during the services, he told me to say, "We have seen the need here, and I promise to come through for you. We'll raise a bit of money to help you to put the roof." And for sure, he was updating me how people are responding. From time to time, he tell me, "We have raised so much." We are also doing something as a church. We raise a bit of money. He shared to a friend of his by the name of Mark Naido, and Mark Naido also joined in to start raising some funds, you know. By the time it was about to be rain season, you know, the money for the roof was found. And that time, it was just about to rain. The rains were about to start, you know, and the man was sent. When we put our money, and the man that came from the two, it was able to make, you know, the whole total budget of the roof. And that's how we put the roof. Immediately after putting the roof, the rains came. I really appreciate God. He saved the church. I remember one time I was moving in the street, and there were three ladies were seated by the wayside. I wanted to bypass them. The Holy Spirit says, "Minister to these ladies." And I stopped there. I started ministering salvation to them. And all of them responded, and they gave their life to Christ. The following day, I was making a follow-up. I found this man who was a drunkard. You know, he was a womanizer, he was a drunkard, and I ministered the gospel to him. He was just staying in one room. I remember even seeing the mat where they were sleeping, you know. They were just staying in one room. And this man responded to the gospel. He gave his life to Christ, totally transformed, and very serious with God. And these are the people who started, you know, supporting us. And from that very time, you know, 2002, up to today, these are the people who are really supporting us in ministry. Another remarkable thing is the time that I was just preaching through the same compound, it's a shared compound. I was preaching there. I saw a young lady, you know, she was having lunch, you know, and the Holy Spirit says, can you minister to that lady? You know, she was having lunch. I didn't want to disturb her, so I mounted some few steps and waited for her, you know, to finish eating. After some time, I went back to her. I preached to her. She was totally checked by the power of God. And that lady, up to this day, she is one of the power supporters in the church. She sings in the praise. Her name is Juliet. You know, so that was very remarkable for me. Another incident that happened was there's one lady, was one man who was running, you know, a shabin, you know, where he was selling beer, this man. And one day I was moving, you're just by the market side. I was moving, the Holy Spirit said, minister to that man. You know, I started going to him, ministering to him, which was quite an embarrassing situation sometimes, because you'd find when you go there, you find the drunkards around him. And as a pastor, sometimes you feel very uncomfortable. You know, you think, how are people going to think about me, you know, going where people are drinking and they're selling beer, you know. But, you know, the conviction was so strong, you know, that every time I want to avoid, I'll hear the voice say, go after that man, you know. And I went as many times as possible. Sometimes you find the man is drunk, but the Holy Spirit was saying, pursue him, you know. Until one day, I had a dream. I saw that place becoming white. You know, it's a whiteness that I've never seen in my life. You know, and I heard the voice saying, I have swept that place. I've swept it. So the following day I went there, I thought the man now is totally changed. But I found he was drunk. You know, I told him, he said, no, God has swept this place. This place is clean. And you are saved already. You don't just know. God has really, you know, delivered you. You know, so it didn't happen there and then. I continued to minister to that man, and until one day he says, no, I just want to give my life to Christ. So this man gave his life to Christ. All the structures which had built there, where they were drinking from, he destroyed them. And we started having a cell in that church. And this is the couple that is standing with us up to today.